Transmission begins.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
This is the Josh Tolley Show on the GCN Radio Network.
All right, we are talking to Roger Stone, last segment before we got in the show. And Roger, there's a couple things I want to make sure we get to. One is the RNC strategy here anyway. This isn't something new. I've been involved with the RNC on a grassroots level for a while now, especially in Wisconsin. It's a very odd situation there. But, I mean, they did this to Ron Paul. If you remember back to the last presidential election, they didn't even seat the delegates from Maine. They took a floor vote, and the teleprompter won because they already had the ayes had it, even though the nays definitely outvoted the ayes. So then they changed the rules. I mean, this is what I love about the Trump campaign is not necessarily his campaign itself, but the fact that it's shining the light on how perverted, corrupt, and horrific the party system is.
Yeah, and the lobbyist class, at the end of the day, very sadly, they would rather have a President Hillary Clinton than a President Donald Trump as a Republican.
Yeah.
Because they realize Hillary is transactional. She's not really a liberal or a progressive. She's just for sale. It's all about the money. And therefore, if you're a party leader who doubles as a lobbyist, like most of them do, quite sadly, then you have access to corporate cash for campaign contributions, well, then Hillary is accessible to you. So that is why they are, I think, so bent on destroying Trump. And, yes, they will try to hijack this in the Rules Committee or the Credentials Committee. I wrote a long piece at stonezone.com, which you can see, warning about Trojan horse delegates. Let me give you the best possible example. The state of Texas, 100 delegates. Based on the primary results and primary rules, Donald Trump is entitled to 40 votes of those 100 votes, Ted Cruz to 60. The problem is that the 40 people who will actually fill the seats of the Trump delegates are anti-Trump. So they will vote against him on Rules and Credentials Committee. So theoretically, if the Credentials Committee moved to unseat Trump delegates, or the Rules Committee moved to declare delegates who are elected with non-Republican votes in the primaries, meaning Democrats, like South Carolina, whose state party rules allow that, and it went to a ratification to the full convention as required by the rules, Trump doesn't, even if he has a majority on the first ballot, he will not have a majority on the question of rules. And the rules have to be adopted and the credentials have to be adopted before the first ballot for president. Therein lies the potential trap for Donald Trump that the kingmakers are setting for him.
See, and that's crazy. You brought up something that the Republicans would be happier voting for Hillary Clinton. And on the show on Showtime called The Circus, which I believe you were actually on, they did a roundtable of Republican operatives, you know, kingmakers. And
yes,
you are absolutely right. They were saying, you know what, for the first time I'm thinking about voting for a Democrat. So see, folks, these people who are at the top, they're just playing a game with your life. And this is why you really have to listen to Roger. But Roger, the question remains, what's the point? I mean, okay, so you're talking to the delegates, you're finding out what hotels they're at, you're going to have the day of rage, maybe it's a mini, you know, march down the street or whatever, but the party's still the party. How do you get Trump in the White House?
Well, he's still more than capable of winning 1,237 votes. Also, never underestimate the ambition of a politician. If Trump is 100 votes short, I can think of several places that Trump could go in the party to get 100 votes. Because somebody wants to be vice president, or somebody wants to have a major voice in the administration. So Trump is in the driver's seat as long as he is closest to the nomination, and Ted Cruz is several hundred votes behind him. There is no accommodation that Ted Cruz will be able to make that would get him nominated on the first or second and perhaps even the third ballot. So Trump goes into the convention in a commanding position, but without a majority, and this is the key, if he has an adept and extremely well-oiled convention operation where he has tight communications with his supporters and a good analysis of the opportunities and strategic options, he could still very well emerge as the nominee. If he does not have those things, if he demonstrates the kind of lack of organization that he had in Wisconsin, then yes, the Republican Party burgers will steal him blind.
What about the line that Cruz keeps delivering, that Trump can't beat Hillary?
On the contrary, the guy who can't beat Hillary is Ted Cruz. Name any state where he would be competitive. The candidacy of Ted Cruz is far too extreme, including his kind of strange evangelical Christian pastor father, who's a very shady character. That whole narrative is not going to work. Ted Cruz is viewed as an extremist. I can't think of any Midwestern or Northeastern industrial state where he would be competitive. Ted Cruz cannot and will not win Ohio. Ted Cruz cannot and will not win Florida. Those are must-carry states for us. Ted Cruz's appeal is extremely limited. Look at the states he's won so far. There's not one big industrial state that this guy's done well. He's not going to do well in Pennsylvania. He's not going to do well in New York. In fact, I'd predict to you, John Kasich will run ahead of him in New York. Ted Cruz will be third. And then there's his personality. This
Sure.
guy wants to be Reagan, but he's really Nixon. Look how shifty those eyes are. Look how untrustworthy he looks on television.
Very true.
I just think that the whole package there is unelectable.
Then why are there so many quote-unquote conservative pundits? Now, I don't believe they're conservative. I think they're a little neoconish. But people like Glenn Beck, for example, saying, well, if you're not voting for Ted Cruz, you're not reading your Bible. Why have these people left conservatism?
Payoffs. That's why. And I have a piece that will be published shortly. Mark Levin taking a payoff. Eric Erickson taking a payoff. Glenn Beck taking a payoff. You can call it bribery if you want. That's why. I just answered your question.
Wow. So
and
what,
that is all very documentable, as you will see.
I'm waiting to see it, and you have an open invitation to come back on this show once you publish that piece. But you...
It'll be at StoneZone.com, I think, later today. I've got to edit it, but I've done very substantial research. I mean, Mark Levin, this guy attacks me on the radio. He attacks me for being a Nixon Republican. Hey, Mark, Richard Nixon saved your beloved Israel single-handedly in the 1973 Yom Kippur War. Without Nixon, over the objection of Kissinger, over the objection of his own State Department, airlifting $100 million plus worth of lethal aid to Israel, Israel would be extinct today. But worse than that, Mark, don't attack me on the radio but then refuse to engage. I'll debate Mark Levin any place, any time, and it will be an ass kick. So, Mark, bring it on.
So what's the payoff? Real quickly, what are they getting for abandoning conservative values?
Cash money.
Whew.
The green stuff, greenbacks, granolas, bread, cabbage.
Wow.
They're all for sale. Look, I like Glenn Beck. He's been very good to me in terms of covering my books. He's been very gracious to me. Why he has become such a drooler, why he has become so virulently opposed to Donald Trump, the answer, I think, is in cash money.
Well, you know, I've always wondered, because Ted Cruz is not a conservative. Any way you skin it, he's just not. And he is very shifty. You can just look at him and say, ooh, this guy's dangerous. But it is what it is. Roger, thank you so much for joining us. I got to tell you, we're going to have you back on, because this thing is not over, not in a long shot. And I want to cover next time you're on why you're getting kicked off MSNBC.
Yeah, no, I've now been banned in some kind of Soviet-style ban. So there's three possibilities. One, they are banning me because I'm politically incorrect. Two, they're banning me because I'm for Donald Trump. Or three, they're banning me because I'm so much better dressed than any of their anchors. I'm not sure which one it is.
Or four, you're revealing a truth that they don't want to get out there. When it was Ron Paul and just kind of fringy, then it was easy to say, oh, yeah, kooky Ron Paul, he looks like Mr. Magoo and all these Paul bots. But now that it's Donald Trump and it's being exposed in a much larger fashion, I think anybody who exposes the truth and is really conservative, or what I call preservative, is being banished by the media outlets. So, Stay strong, Roger. We'll have you back on, my friend. All right, that does it for today, folks. We're out of here. Remember, look into jury nullification. No victim, no crime. YouTubers, stay where you're at. We're going to keep this going a little bit. Today, tomorrow, and as always, my friends, may your path lead to heaven, and may freedom follow in your footsteps. Is he still there by chance?
No, he took off.
Yeah, that's what I figured. That's cool. Can you disconnect me from your side?
Yeah, no problem. Have a good day.
All right, YouTuber, stand by. All right, so there you go. Roger Stone, the guy who's being banished by the media. Now, please remember that this is not an endorsement of Trump. This show, Roger being on, was not an endorsement of Trump. Rather, it was exposing what the Cruz machine is doing, what the RNC machine is doing, how they hate your vote, and how these people who we thought were conservative, who we thought stood for the Constitution, who we thought stood for the people, are really not. And it's really disappointing to see some of the people who have pave the way in talk radio, just abandon the Constitution, just abandon things that are important. Like I said, I don't understand how if you own a Bible, a Constitution, a brain, and a calculator, you can come up with Ted Cruz as a conservative. That just doesn't float. And don't give me the, well, he filibustered once. No, he filibustered on something he knew wasn't going to pass, and he did it so he could gain the street cred of a conservative. Meanwhile, on the vote that really could get him real cred, the audit the Fed, he didn't show up because he knew it wouldn't pass. Well, that's illogical if you're really a conservative. And like I said before, you would never, ever have your name attached to Senate Bill 247, nor would you be attached to the one that passed last year, where they have the ability to strip you of your passport if you owed back taxes. No conservative would ever vote for those things. And in this case, not only did Ted Cruz vote for one of them, but he also sponsored and authored the other one. So conservative? No, not a chance. Now, again, that doesn't mean that Donald Trump is some awesome conservative candidate, and no, I'm not endorsing him. I've said this before, and I will say it again. The one thing that is guaranteed in November, regardless of who you vote for, even Ted Cruz, is that your government is going to get bigger. Hey, thanks for watching. If you loved what I had to say, then subscribe right here. If you hated what I had to say, subscribe right here. It's fun being mad on social media, isn't it? Either way, I'd love to hear from you. Send me an email right there.